So congratulations, you've been accepted onto an MBA program. But what are my 10 pieces of advice for how you can make sure you get the maximum value from your time on the MBA program? Well, the first piece of advice is you're going to be so incredibly busy. With all the faculty, you have to remember, we have a whole world of research and thinking and frameworks, things we want to share with you, and we have a very small amount of time to really cram as much as we can into it. So we are going to really load you up with a whole bunch of stuff on every course that you take. And clearly, if you're studying and working at the same time, you have all the work commitments, and many of you clearly will have personal commitments outside of your study and your work. If you're in a long-term relationship, then you clearly have to invest some time there rather than having an MBA widow or widower. And somebody asked me a while back, what does a long-term relationship really mean? If you have to ask the question, then you're not in a long-term relationship. And obviously, it's not just a significant other. It's also if you've got kids, then you have all of these commitments. So it's going to be incredibly busy time in your life. The temptation is that you're just trying to get through it. You're sort of hanging on by your fingernails, getting the readings done, getting the cases prepared, getting the exams thoroughly prepared for as well. And once they're over, the risk is you just move on to the next course and the next assignment. But there's a phrase that originates in Florida. They say, when you're fighting off the alligators, it's hard to remember you were trying to drain the swamp. And here's the risk. You end up spending all your time on the MBA program just fighting alligators in survival mode. So the crucial piece of advice that I would offer you is get a small book, a physical book, because if you actually write something down physically, there's a whole bunch of studies show that your recall is significantly higher than if you type it into a computer. I love these moleskin books. I think they do a really nice job. At the end of every lecture, if you religiously write down 2 or 3 bullet points about the things that really struck you about that lecture, if you do that at the end of every lecture, by the end of your MBA, you will have really captured the really key lessons for you. So make sure you really get time to reflect, write things down in your book, spend time discussing with your study group, with other students on your cohort about what did they take out of it? What did you make of this? Because really capturing that learning is very important. So the first piece of advice is don't just rush around fighting the alligators, protect time to really think about what am I learning as we go through this experience. The second piece of advice is resist the pressure to conform. Now, Solomon Asch in the 1950s did seminal research looking at what we call conformity pressure. And here's an example of one of his experiments.
But an experiment is not a public opinion poll. It examines behavior under the pressure of social forces, as the experiment of Solomon Asch reveals.
The experiment you'll be taking part in today involves the perception of lengths of lines. As you can see here, I have a number of cards, and on each card there are several lines. Your task is a very simple one. You're to look at the line on the left and determine which of the 3 lines on the right is equal to it in length. All right, we'll proceed in this order. You'll give your answer.
Only one of the people in the group is a real subject, the fifth person with the white t-shirt. The others are confederates of the experimenter and have been told to give wrong answers on some of the trials. The experiment begins uneventfully as subjects give their judgments.
Two. Three.
But on the third trial, something happens.
Two.
The subject denies the evidence of his own eyes and yields to group influence. Asch found subjects went along with the group on 37% of the critical trials. But he found through interviews that they went along with the group for different reasons.
One.
They must be right. There are 4 of them and 1 of me.
One.
This subject's yielding is based on a distortion of his judgment. He genuinely believes that the group is correct.
Now, you might laugh at this guy, but all of us have this pressure to conform. And specifically on the MBA, the conformity pressure can be around looking for the right answer. that's completely misunderstanding what an advanced degree like an MBA is really trying to do in terms of your learning. Because there is no one right answer. It's about coming up with an informed point of view. Now, many people love to read books by CEOs. And there's many CEOs write these kind of books, perhaps most famously, the great Jack Welch, who ran General Electric from 1981 to 2001, and was one of the, certainly one of the greatest CEOs of the 20th century. He grew the market capitalization from $19 billion to over $500 billion. And if you want to know what Jack Welch thinks about business and about leadership, it's very easy. You just read one of the many, many, many books that he's authored around organizations and business. And there's a problem, however, with reading these books, and it's a pretty fundamental problem. And the problem is this: there's only one person on the planet that can do Jack Welch, and that is Jack Welch. It's not you. And here's the problem of reading books by CEOs. It's what a colleague of mine calls Heathrow Business School. Is when you go to Heathrow Airport, if you've ever passed through it, you'll know that when you get through all the security into the duty-free area, there's a bookshop there. And there's an entire section with books about business. And it's full of books by these celebrity CEOs giving you answers. And every single one of these books, without hesitation, has the same formula, which is this: I became CEO. The organization was a mess. I transformed it. Look at what I have achieved. And if you want to be successful in business, you need to be just like me because I'm fairly magnificent. And they then tell you what they did. And you read this on the airplane and you are inspired. This is the answer. But there's a problem here, which is that that's what they did. And by the way, you're not Jack Welch. You're not chairman and CEO of GE in 1981. So if you do in your career what he did in his role at that point in time, I can pretty much guarantee it's going to be a disaster. So my advice is this: never read books by CEOs. In fact, if you ever bought one of these books, take them and throw them on the fire, because often it's more about vanity and trying to, you know, create their legacy than necessarily about the reality of what they actually really did. And so trying to find the right answer, trying to find this Heathrow Business School, what's the one thing that I need to do, is completely misunderstanding what it means to really get value out of an MBA. Because you aren't Jack Welch. You could try and become like Jack Welch, but you're going to fail. But that's not the point. The point is, people who have great careers don't focus on trying to be like somebody else. They really figure out what their strengths are and spend as much time as they can playing to those strengths. So don't focus on your weaknesses, the things that aren't good about you. You'll need a coping strategy for those, of course, but really the great careers and the people who on their MBA get the most value are the ones who really use this time to really figure out and develop their strengths. So on the MBA program, take the time to really reveal your personality. Don't try and fit in. Really try and find your authentic leadership voice. Take risks, experiment, rather than trying to find the right answer and trying to please the professor or, you know, try and impress your other MBA students. Take those sort of risks to really find what your perspective is, rather than feeling that pressure to conform. So that's my second piece of advice. The third piece of advice is build your network. Because clearly on your MBA, you're going to learn a huge amount of stuff. The weighted average cost of capital, the capital asset pricing model, Black-Scholes formula, all these kind of concepts, which are going to be very useful for you. But at its essence, an MBA isn't simply about teaching you theory and knowledge. Because as you increasingly get on in your career, it's not going to be about what you know, but who you know. So in 1973, Mark Granovetter published what is probably the most cited article in the history of social psychology, which was an article about called The Strength of Weak Ties. And this is a very powerful concept, because what Granovetter found is that if you want to find a job, if you want to find a partner in life, then actually you need to know lots of people not very well. So in your time on the MBA program, don't sort of hang out in your little clique of people who are probably quite similar to you in whatever that may mean. You need to make sure that you build a relationship with every single person in your cohort of the MBA program, and maybe in other MBA programs as well. Other programs go on at the school. Build relationships with faculty and get involved in the social life of the school. You don't have to do everything, of course, but one of the most consistent regrets that I find amongst MBA students is I really wish I'd spent more time on the social activities. There's obviously some clubs, be it a private equity club, be it regional clubs that particular may be of interest to you. There may be some more social activities there that are interesting to you, but really make sure you get to know as many people as possible. And when I say get to know them, it means that in 6 months' time or 5 years' time, when you contact them and say, hey, remember me? They say, yes, yeah, sure. And if you say, look, I need your help, then they say, sure, no problem. So that's when you know you've really got a network. You've got enough people there and as many people as you possibly can who would actually return that call. So build your network out. The fourth point here is, what we're trying to do on the MBA program isn't really just about data transfer. And as Einstein famously said, education is what remains after you've forgotten what you learned at school. It's not just about the theory. Crucially, that study group process where you're spending time in a small group is where you're going to get much of the enjoyment and a lot of the learning, not just about the content, but about the process of how you can really work together. And in that study group, you've got a great opportunity here to practice the behaviors that will really make people want to follow you. It's not about being inauthentic, but it is about really practicing these and being somebody who is worthy of trust. Because at the end of your MBA program, you would be able to, I'm not going to encourage you to do this, but you could very effectively evaluate each of your fellow MBA students on a scale of 1 to 10 about how much do I trust this person. And so where would you score on this? Because being worthy of trust, having what Warren Buffett calls character, is, I would argue, absolutely crucial. And you can really work on being worthy of trust and really in that small group environment, practice these behaviors. So it's not simply just about data transfer. Really practice those experiences, practice those behaviors. The fifth one here is what I would call live Ubuntu. Now, Ubuntu is a phrase that originates as part of a Zulu phrase and is very often used amongst many African communities to really talk about this community, this kinship, this sense of humanity, as sometimes it's described, a person is a person through other people. And so this African concept of community is for me very important. It's people like Bill Clinton and Archbishop Desmond Tutu have talked about Ubuntu quite frequently. So it's been getting a lot of exposure in the press. But the point I want to make about Ubuntu on your MBA is everyone matters in a digital world. You may think that you only need to hang out with the brightest MBA students, that small little clique. But as I've said already, you need to have a broader network, but it's not just your MBA students. For me, there's a really important point here, which is about how you treat the people who you don't think can affect your career. And in particular here, I'm talking about the staff at the business school. And I want to make a slightly challenging point here. I want to really say you have absolutely no right to be disrespectful of the staff at the business school. They do an incredibly hard job. It's not an easy job at all. They will almost always do it with a polite, professional, smiling face, however badly some MBA students treat them. And over the years at a number of different business schools, I have to say, I have come across moments when I would argue the behavior by some of the MBA students is entirely inappropriate. You never have the right to treat these people that way, not just for some ethical or values-based sense, but here's the thing. You don't know who is going to be important to you in your future career. And with all of these networks that are around there, actually everyone matters. I remember one guy on the way to his MBA interview. He was coming into at London Business School. He was coming into the school and he was parking his motorbike and actually knocked over another motorbike. And I happened to be walking past there. And I came up and I said, "Are you okay?" And he said, "Yeah, unfortunately, this person's motorbike here. Do you know whose it is?" I said, "Actually, I do. It's my motorbike." And I was actually just about to interview him. So you never know somebody passing you on the street, whether this is important or not, but everybody matters. So there's something here I call MBA-itis, a disease here. And MBA-itis is something that is pretty common amongst MBA students. And I want to draw a distinction here between two very different things. On one side, you've got self-esteem, this real sense of I am a person of worth, I have a right to be successful. It's linked to a sense of self-efficacy, which is I'm capable and I'm going to do well. And that is healthy, that sense of confidence that I'm going to be successful in my career. On the other side, we've got something very different, which is narcissism. And one academic who studies this described narcissism as, if I ruled the world, it would be a much better place. Now, here's the reality of the situation. MBA students are one of the most narcissistic groups that have ever been studied. And narcissism is fine as long as it's not out of control. Having that real sense of I'm fantastic, it can get out of control. So you need to be able to balance that narcissism with a sense of humility. I remember many years ago, a recruiter from a firm that takes a lot of MBA students was talking to me and she said, "Look, yeah, the problem with MBA students is we don't really want to be the first person to hire somebody after their MBA. Because they come in there into the organization and they think they know it all. And they say things, oh, you guys don't understand strategy. Oh, doing it completely wrong here. And after a while, they realize it's not quite as easy in the real world of business as it perhaps was in your air-conditioned lecture theater. And, you know, once they've sort of learned that the complexity of being particularly in mid and senior level positions, then they learn that humility. But make sure you avoid this MBA-itis. And some students, you know, they sort of put their hand up and are constantly trying to prove that they're smarter than their professor. Ah, I caught you out here. You said this last week and now you're saying this and I've got you here. And the professor will hopefully be polite and smile and try not to humiliate you. But even if you are smart, professor, congratulations, but I can absolutely guarantee you, if you're asking questions purely because you want to show that you're smarter than the professor, it's certainly pretty boring to the other MBA students and certainly boring to most of the faculty as well. So only ask a question if you genuinely want to know the answer. So this MBA-itis is something that, you know, with faculty, look, you can take it on with faculty. You can be as challenging, as demanding as you want, bring it on. But certainly how you treat people that are less powerful than you, feeling too pleased with yourself is something that you need to be careful of. So live Ubuntu, really have the sense of everyone really matters. We're all part of a community. Treat every individual with respect. The next point here is take responsibility for your community. Now, in 1913, the French agricultural engineer, Max Ringelmann, published a seminal paper. And what he'd done is he'd studied tug of war teams. And what he's trying to figure out is how much could each individual pull? And he measured the strength of each individual in the team. And then he measured the strength of the team. And what he found is that when you have three people pulling on the same rope, they only have the strength of 2.5 people. When you have 8 people, they only have the strength of 4 people. There's an exponential factor kicking in here. And this is what we sometimes call social loafing. There's always that temptation when you're in a group situation, such as a study group, not to pull your weight. Some people almost get a pleasure out of proving that they're clever and no one realized they were doing it. This is the thing, people do notice. Even if you think you're brilliant at getting away with it, if you're not prepared for that study group meeting, if you haven't really contributed on time. And there's a point here from terms of personality. Of all the five major personality variables, there's one that's most correlated with managerial success, and that's conscientiousness. And this is being organized and delivering reliably on your promises. So in your study group process, don't be the person who's not pulling their weight. Actively participate. Don't be a passenger. And this really operates particularly importantly in any small group process that you have. And I would even go further than that. There's a concept here we talk about in terms of reciprocity. And reciprocity is going out of your way to be helpful to other people. As they say in biblical terms, you reap what you sow. If you unconditionally go out of your way to be helpful to the people on your MBA program, in terms of, you know, if you are an expert, for example, in accounting or corporate finance, maybe putting on a little workshop where you might help people understand some concepts that other people were struggling with. But there are some people who consistently go out of the way to be helpful to other people. And in terms of our understanding of influence, reciprocity is the most powerful way of really building your social capital. So this point here is really take responsibility for your community rather than being this social loafer who's really the bystander here, the passenger in any group process. The next point here is perhaps a little bit surprising, which is have your midlife crisis early. Now, what do I mean by this? Well, you have come to business school to get answers. How do you value a business? What should I do with my career? What are my key strengths? What are the things I really need to focus on in order to achieve all of my career ambitions? The problem is that many people, in my experience, when they get to the end of the MBA program, they're actually left with more questions than answers. So you came here for answers, but you actually end up with more questions. And that can be, for some MBA students, at the end of the MBA, they can be sort of frustrated with this. Why haven't I got more clarity about what I should be doing? Well, for me, this is actually a healthy situation to be in. Because my experience, having for almost 25 years now coached senior executives, is that many people think that all I need to do is just simply climb the corporate ladder, and then I'll be happy. My experience is that just doesn't work. And Benjamin Franklin once said, some men die age 25, but aren't buried until they're 75. And I have to admit, in my work with organizations, I would argue a large percentage of executives died age 25. And they're just there climbing the corporate ladder, trying to get to the top. And here's the really depressing thing is if you get to the top of that specific ladder and you realize maybe it's the wrong ladder, that's a real midlife crisis. So on the MBA, you will be thinking through some difficult questions. Well, I thought I wanted to do this. Is that really right for me? So stay with the difficult questions. Because so far in your career, many of you will have said, well, I haven't had to manage my career. Good things have just happened to me. Things have gone really well. I haven't had to take responsibility for any way managing my career. They've just looked after me. But the reality is this. In the second half of your career, you have to manage your career. Because no one's going to look after you. Your boss isn't responsible for you. HR aren't going to look after you enough. Nobody else is going to actively manage your career. So which ladder should I be on? And really thinking much more deeply about the questions, the difficult questions that don't often have simple, neat answers about what does success look like for me in my career? Where should I be really focusing my energies over the next 12 months? What's going to be the right next role for me? All of these are difficult questions. So when I say have your midlife crisis early, what I really mean is stay with those difficult questions, because figuring out who we are and what success really means to us, I would argue, is a lifetime's work. So what's my eighth piece of advice? Well, having taught MBA students for over 20 years now, it's striking to me how different, even within the same MBA course at the same business school, how different the culture is you get in different sections or different streams. And yet we're teaching the same content, certainly I'm the same person, and yet the culture that gets created in the classroom varies enormously. Because whilst we clearly, as a business school and as members of faculty, shape the culture, the environment a lot, you as MBA students really define the environment you create. And in the over 50 years of history at London Business School, without doubt, the greatest professor we've ever had in the school was the great Soumantra Ghoshal, a brilliant professor of strategy. And he was at the school for 12 years. And I had the privilege of getting to know him for 5 years, but tragically, he died well before his time in 2005. But Soumantra was just, he was just way ahead of the rest of us. He could just see things more clearly than the rest of us. You know, you look back at articles he wrote decades earlier and you just think, my God, this guy could really see the world more clearly than the rest of us. And Soumantra was famous because with pretty much every group he ever taught, he shared the same story. And it's a story that's resonated with executives around the world. And in the story, he compares and contrasts two very different environments.
Individuals do not change fundamentally in who they are without a very serious personal crisis of some kind. But the conclusion, again, for us, perhaps the key conclusion is that is a wrong question to ask. Revitalizing people has a lot less to do with changing people and has a lot more to do with changing the context that companies, that senior managers, that people in this room create around their people. Now, context, some manager called it the smell of the place. It's a hard thing to describe. And let me try to describe it the best way I experience it through my sort of personal experience, if you wish. I teach at the London Business School. I live in London, have done so for the last year and a half. Before that, I lived in Fontainebleau in France for about 8 years. But one look at me and then one sound of my accent, and you know I do not come from either of these two wonderful places in the world. I come from India, from the eastern part of India. My hometown is the city of Calcutta. So every year I go to Calcutta in the month of July. That's the only time when my children have a summer vacation. Now, Calcutta is a wonderful town in winter, autumn, and spring. But summer, well, the temperature is 102, 103. The humidity is about 99%. And I feel very tired. Most of my vacation, I'm tired. I'm indoors. I used to live in Fontainebleau. And this, I genuinely challenge you. Go to the forest of Fontainebleau in spring. Go with a firm desire to have a leisurely walk. And you can't. The moment you enter the forest, there is something about the crispness of the air. There is something about the smell of the trees in spring. You'd want to jump. You'd want to jog. You want to catch a branch, run, do something. And that, I believe, is the essence of the problem. Most companies, particularly large companies, have created downtown Calcutta in summer inside themselves. And then they complain. They say, you know, you are lazy and you don't take initiative and you don't take cooperation. You are not changing the company. The issue is, it's not about changing me. I have a lot of energy in spring in Fontainebleau, and I'm a bit tired in summer in Calcutta. And that's the issue. To change, ultimately, beyond all these abstractions of strategy, of organization, of processes, at the end, the issue is, how do we change the context? How do we create Fontainebleau Forest inside companies?
I think this is a brilliant analogy, because what kind of environment are you going to create in your class on your MBA program? So my eighth piece of advice is create a positive environment. Create a forest of Fontainebleau rather than downtown Calcutta in the middle of summer. But there is a reality here that there will be setbacks. You may have personal setbacks. Clearly, given the number of people on the MBA class, there'll be people there who have difficult experiences in their professional and in their personal lives, sometimes very difficult experiences. You may be, you know, really struggling in all sorts of ways, and it may not just be stuff outside of the MBA. There may be one instructor didn't really sort of gel with the class and people are frustrated with that. It maybe you didn't get the choice of elective courses that you really wanted and you're frustrated with this. Maybe you thought you'd done really well in an exam and you're frustrated with how you've been graded there or you were given information. There are things that go wrong inevitably. Always in life, stuff happens, as the saying goes. But here's the point I want to make here. You can't control everything that happens to you. But there is one thing you can always control, which is how you respond when you experience setbacks. And as Nietzsche says, what doesn't kill me makes me stronger. And are you going to bring this resilient attitude to your MBA classroom and make sure that not just you, but you have this impact on the people around you, that actually when things go wrong and things aren't exactly the way you wanted, how are you really going to cope with this? Are you, even when there's bad times, things aren't going exactly the way you wanted, are you going to create this high energy environment, or are you going to create downtown Calcutta in the middle of summer? You have the choice. So influence your class, influence this environment to create as positive an environment as you can. The ninth point here is an MBA doesn't entitle you to anything. So this isn't like Clark Kent going into a telephone box and emerging as Superman. This isn't a sort of transformational experience, or no miracle is going to occur. Now, we are going to give you hopefully one of the most stimulating times in your life and a huge amount of content that's going to be helpful to you in your future career. But as Aristotle famously said, we are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act, but a habit. It's easy to perform a good action, but not easy to acquire a settled habit of performing such actions. You have certain patterns of behavior and they've worked for you. You know, the reason you're doing an MBA is you've already been successful in your life and in your career. So we have these embedded patterns of behavior. And this is a great opportunity for you to really get beyond simply thinking about what am I doing? How am I behaving right now? And think in a more profound way about what you can really take out of this experience. Because if you've ever seen the movie The Matrix, there's a scene where Morpheus says, there's a difference between knowing the path and walking the path.
Neo, sooner or later you're going to realize, just as I did, there's a difference between knowing the path and walking the path.
And the challenge for you is not just to know the path, but to really walk the path, to be a role model of the behaviors that you want from others. The Danish philosopher Søren Kierkegaard said, the highest of all is not to understand the highest, but to act upon it. So you'll have all of this stuff that you're learning, but are you really going to live by the values you want to be known by from others? Or as Arnold Schwarzenegger famously said, nobody ever got muscles watching me work out. This is not a spectator sport. It's not about this passive learning. It's not about sitting in the classroom, absorbing content. It's not about there listening to a bunch of TED Talks to really learn stuff. It's about really practicing these behaviors. So if you've ever been in London, you may have been in the back of a black cab. And if you have, you'll know that the cab driver has two key responsibilities. Number one, to drive you from A to B, but number two, to share his or her point of view about the world. And they've figured it all out. They have answers about sport, about politics, about immigration. They've just figured it all out. And that's why they're driving a cab. Because actually, it's easy to tell everyone else what they should do. It's what I call the cab driver syndrome. But MBA students, the ones who really go on and succeed, in my experience, are the ones who don't just know the theory. They're the ones that really live by the values that will make them successful. As the great Mahatma Gandhi said, be the change you wish to see in the world. Don't talk about it. Don't tell everyone else what they should be doing. Really, the great MBA students are the ones who use that time to really focus on the behaviors that will really make them successful. So if you want to go out there into the world and change it, you have to really live those values. You have to be the change you wish to see in the world. And my final, my 10th piece of advice is take personal risks. Now, in your career, every time you try and make a change in how things are done in the organization, everyone around you will say, oh, that's great, but be careful. That's fine, but don't break anything. Because in your career, you'll consistently be made to feel that you are in a china shop. This whole analogy of being in a china shop is what it feels like always in your career. But whilst it will always feel like you're in a china shop and you mustn't break anything, and as a clumsy person like myself, this is, you know, a terrifying analogy, but the reality is that organizations are not china shops. They're more like gardens. It's very hard to kill a garden. You may have tried, but you know, you can make mistakes in a garden. If you move something and it doesn't work, you can plant another one, you can move things around. And here's the reality: organizations and careers are more resilient than you think they are. And particularly in the second half of your career, you're more likely to fail because you're being too careful about not making any mistakes, rather than trusting your judgments, trusting your instincts that have been honed in your time on the MBA program, and really taking those risks. As Mark Twain famously said, 20 years from now, you'll be more disappointed by the things that you didn't do than by the ones you did do. So throw off the bowlines, the ropes, sail away from the safe harbor. In your time on the MBA program, take risks. This isn't a china shop. So don't just pick the courses, particularly the elective courses, they're gonna be the easy, comfortable ones where you can get high scores. Really make sure you don't just go for the home games, you take some away games there. You do some things that are not gonna be comfortable for you. You really experience what we call good pain. Things that when you do them and you apply yourself to them, you really develop your capacity to cope with things that you didn't think you could cope with beforehand. And so the final framework I'd really share with you here is, in your time on the MBA program, you can be in one of three zones. You could be in the comfort zone where it's easy, familiar, and you know what you're doing. Or you could be in the stretch zone. And the stretch zone is not comfortable. It's difficult. It's hard work. It's this good pain. But the more time you spend in it, the more you grow, the more you develop, the more you really develop your capacities. Now, there is a zone beyond that, the non-operational zone, where we're overwhelmed and overloaded. And clearly, this is a bad place to be, because this is when we revert back to some simple basic skills. So the challenge of your MBA is to spend as much time as you can at really the top end of your stretch zone, to really push yourself so that you really end up at the end of this experience having developed this sense of self-efficacy, having really developed the confidence to go into almost any situation, knowing that you can talk to people and you can bring people together to really achieve things that before your MBA, you didn't know you can do. So these are my 10 pieces of advice. The first of them, don't just be fighting the alligators. Really stop and think and make sure you capture your learning. Secondly, resist the pressure to conform. All of this conformity pressure, but you've got a great opportunity here to really experiment here, to take some risks, to develop your authentic leadership voice, to really figure out what your strengths are. Thirdly, build your network. It's very important here. You don't just focus on your small group of people you get on particularly well with, or just with your study group. You get this strength of weak ties, as many people as you can in that community, and not just the academic stuff. If you possibly can, engage more broadly in the life of the community life of the business school. Fourth, it's not just about data transfer. Particularly here, it's about really practicing these behaviors that will make people really want to follow you. So you've got an opportunity to really develop that trustworthiness, that real character. Fifth, live Ubuntu. Don't be sort of this MBA-itis person who's very demanding here. Everybody matters in a virtual digital world. You need to make sure you treat everybody with respect. So learn some humility, because at some point in your career, you'll be learning it. So if you don't have that strength yet, my advice is really practice it right now. Sixth, take responsibility for your community. Don't be a social loafer. Really actively participate. This is not a spectator sport. And go beyond that and really live reciprocity. Go out of your way unconditionally to be helpful to other people. Seventh, have your midlife crisis early. Now, you want simple answers, but actually, the challenge here is to stay with difficult questions. Really take responsibility for asking yourself the difficult questions about what success really means to me. Eight, create this positive environment, this energized environment. And it's not just simply when things are going well, it's how we respond to setbacks. Nine, an MBA doesn't really entitle you to anything. It's not some miraculous process. It's about really being a role model of the behaviors you want from others. So don't just simply know the path. You actually have to walk the path. It's your behaviors rather than your words that will really define your success. So really use this time on the MBA to practice those behaviors. And finally, you're not in a China shop. As Mark Twain says, it's really about taking those risks. Because you don't want to end up your career looking back with regrets about if only I'd taken more risks. So take this risk in how you show up on the MBA course and really get into the habit there of really pushing yourself beyond that comfort zone.